equation.
Well, good morning. Welcome to church this morning. I'm glad you could be here. What a great day to be here and worship God. Just a couple of announcements real quick. First of all, tonight we're doing something completely different, a little bit different. We've invited Harrison Avenue Baptist Church to come over, and we're going to have a hymn sing tonight. So if you like hymns, tonight is going to be all you. It's going to be a good night. We have an ice cream social. Immediately following that, we're going to have communion tonight. So that's going to be at 6 o'clock. We normally meet at 6:30, but tonight it's going to be at 6 o'clock. And so I hope you can come and be a part of that. If you can bring some desserts, some ice cream, ice cream social without ice cream is just a social, and that's okay too, but we'll try to throw the ice cream in. We'd love to have you come and be a part of that. We're going to have a VBS meeting right after church for those who are able to, would like to be a part of that. We're going to be talking specifically about how we're going to be decorating and some of those things. So that's going to be down front immediately after our service. And thanks for being here to worship with us today.
I have one. If anybody has any Christmas lights, like white stranded Christmas lights, let me know if you want to let me borrow those for an evening. That's all.
Please stand as we sing together. All the people said,
"Amen."
Oh, come on, try that again. All the people said,
"Amen."
There we go.
Said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen.
thanks. That's great singing this morning. Go ahead and have a seat. This morning, we are recognizing our graduates. And I'd like to just invite, who's our first graduate, Kim? Who?
Jennifer
Spencer. Oh, there she is. Yeah. With a person who looks like that, Jennifer Spencer. Come on up. We're real excited. Jennifer's graduating from Harrison High School, and I want to give her just an opportunity to maybe share a little bit about what's next. So, would you do that? She's following her sister, Sarah, to Liberty. Sarah, I thought about, should I recognize her or not? She is actually graduating in December from Liberty, so no, you don't get it today. All right, sorry. But Jennifer is, we're very excited for you. We have something special for you we'd like to give to you. Yay. There you go. Yeah, thanks. She said, it's really nice wrapping paper. Obviously, I didn't do that. But every year we give I bet you're wondering what it is, right? Definitely, yeah. Well, thanks so much, Jennifer. We have, every year we give the same gift to all the graduates, but we still wrap it and act like it's a big surprise anyway. We also have this year graduating from Harrison High School, Chris Molesky. Chris, where are you at? Can you come up? Great. Chris will be playing the tuba or trombone or something tonight, I'm thinking. Yeah, great. Chris, can you share a little bit about what's next?
This fall, I'll be attending NKU, majoring in nursing, and after that, I hope that I'll be able to go back at some point to get my master's to either go into anesthesiology or nurse practitioner.
Fantastic. Thanks, Chris. They're just overwhelmed with the wrapping job. That's good. Actually, I think Jenna did that, so that's great. Yeah, the corners are even tight. Yeah, that's awesome. We're just so fortunate they have such low expectations, so that's good. We give each of our kids that graduate a commentary set. It's a J. Vernon McGee commentary set, and it's just a great place to go as you go out and you don't know what something means through the whole Bible. It's a good set and kind of a good way to get them kickstarted as they may be going in different directions, something that they can take with them. But we appreciate you, Jennifer. Thank you. And Chris, we very much enjoyed having you here. And I know Chris will be staying here locally. Jennifer headed to Lynchburg, Virginia. And we'll miss you greatly. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you for our morning together and just for the blessings that you give in our lives every day. God, we just want to thank you for Jennifer and Chris and just pray, God, that as they kind of move on to this next phase in their lives, that God, you just watch over them, give them direction, give them wisdom, help them as they kind of go through this time of transition. God, just thank you for the blessings that they have been here and just pray that you just continue to bless them as they kind of go in different directions. Thanks for loving us this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to be here and to worship you. And we just ask that you just bless as we worship you through our giving. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. mind, I cannot stand how far along. Jesus, you're my hope instead.
This time we'll dismiss our children for children's church. And thanks for the great music this morning. I appreciate it. I'd like to take just a minute and recognize those who are graduating from college as well. If you've graduated from college this year, would you stand? Yeah. Congratulations. Ryan, yeah. That was awesome. That was awesome. Yeah, I don't want to minimize that. That's awesome. We're real excited for you and the directions that you are going. Can I put you on the spot this morning? You know, whenever you do that from up here, that's all, I've already done it, so I realize. Can you, Matt, can you stand up and just share maybe what your plans are, so everybody knows?
Yeah. So I love college so much, I'm going back. But without the college. So I'm going to be leaving August 1st to start a position at Virginia Tech doing campus ministry with their Baptist campus ministry for a year. So that's where I feel like the Lord's led me. So most people are like, hey, what'd you get your degree? And I'm like, hey, let's play the education. And they're like, great, where are you going to teach? And I'm like, I'm not.
Should I cut you some slack? All right, I will. But I'm not going to cut Ryan any slack, all right? Ryan, stand up.
Okay, so next year, I'm going to marry the beautiful Maggie.
Yay! Congratulations. Yeah, excited. Thanks, Ryan. Great commercial for small groups that are starting in the fall. So real excited about that. And I'm sorry I kind of put you on the spot, but I'll leave it at that. How's that? Well, we are doing a study on the book of James. And this is just, I love the book of James because it is just basically, it's not comprehensive as far as everything that Christianity is, but it does take it and says, what does Christianity, when you live it out in your everyday life, look like? And I love that because we have a lot of people telling us what church is, and James just kind of clears it up for us in a very practical way. And he addresses subjects in the book of James that you and I probably struggle with somewhat in our Christianity. And just kind of brings these themes out and says, these are things that I'm going to talk about because they probably apply to you. And this is what I'm going to tell you, what real Christianity is. And basically, if you're going to look at the theme for Christianity, it's basically expressing your faith in real life. How do you take this Christianity and these beliefs that we have, and how do we express that in our real lives. So we're going through this. I'm kind of going to divide this up in a little bit different way. So we're in James chapter 1. And as we started off this study, we looked and we saw the role that problems play in our lives and how God can actually take something very good. And he tells us that when problems come, and these tests come, they're tests. And what are they testing? He says he's testing our faith. He says whenever they come, he says, I want you to count it all joy. So he starts off at the very beginning of this with a radical mindset change that he asks us to have. And it's this idea that I am going to trust God in every aspect of my life. And he starts off with the hard thing, with the problems. Then last week we stopped and we spent some time looking at temptations and how do we deal with that. This morning we're going to skip down to verse 27 and just read. We're going to focus on this one verse. Don't worry, we'll come back and get the other stuff. It kind of goes with some other things later in this book. But let's skip down to verse 27 and let's read this. It says, pure religion, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Let me read that again. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. It's kind of interesting that he talks about this, because he says pure religion, this is what pure religion looks like. And he's kind of implying by saying that is that there is religion that's out there that is not pure religion. It's a religion that started off maybe in the right place with the right desires, but somewhere along the line, it became impure. There became other things that were mixed in that should not have been there. Whenever you think about pure, probably it's kind of a gross analogy, but I'm going to share it anyway. The Ohio River. Okay, how many of you water ski on the Ohio River? I don't want to ruin things for you, but let me just kind of talk about something here for a minute. I was at a meeting, and I shared this not a while back, but I was at a meeting in the city of Covington. It was like a neighborhood meeting where I work, and the different businesses come together. It's like a business association. And somebody from the city of Covington was at the meeting, and they were talking about some changes that they were going to make to the sewer systems in Covington. And what I did not realize was that, and I'm not sure if this has been resolved yet, this was several years ago, but until just recently, if not still today, the city of Covington basically dumps all of their sewage untreated into the Ohio River. That's gross, isn't it? I heard that, I thought, really? Are you kidding? But that's the infrastructure that they had. A friend of mine, a coworker of mine, is on Boone County's water rescue team. And so they go and they dive in the Ohio River and do different things, water safety, and do a number of different things. But one of the things that he was sharing with me was he was saying that Doug, there are many days during the summer where we don't allow our divers to dive in the Ohio River because of the bacteria levels that are there. They're suited up, and they're not allowed to dive in the Ohio River. And you look around, and all these other people out there, and they're water skiing, and they're swimming, and they're doing all this stuff. And if you look at it, it looks amazing. If you look at it running on a nice day, I mean, as long as there's not been a lot of rain up river, I mean, it looks nice, it's pretty, it's kind of bluish. I mean, but it's not pure. And in fact, if you drink from that river without some kind of treatment, it can cause you all kinds of problems. And what James is basically saying is this. He's saying that there is a Christianity that on the outside, it looks okay. But it's not. There are issues. It's impure. There's something there that you can't tell the difference by just looking. You have to examine more closely. So that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to take these two things, and these aren't the only two things, but these are the two things that James mentions here about what real Christianity is and about what it looks like.
It says pure religion and undefiled. Now, pure means it's the gospel. It is as God intended it. It is God's word. It's nothing has been added to it. Nothing has been taken away from it. It is undefiled, all right? So what is it? What is pure religion, and what does it look like? It says that pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this. And the first thing he says is to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. Orphans and widows in their trouble. Now, it's kind of interesting. We're having a VBS meeting right after church. And some people say, Pastor Doug, why do we put so much work into Vacation Bible School? It's that time where we draw kids from all over the community, and they come in, and I'll tell you what, at Community Baptist Church, we do Vacation Bible School right. The kids love Vacation Bible School. If you look out here on the side of Vacation Bible School, you will see one of the biggest slip and slides in all of Harrison. Roll a Tyvek, baby shampoo, water, and kids, and that's a great combination, right? We do that. We want them to come out. We want them to have fun. They get treats. They do crafts. They do all kinds of things. But the most important thing that happens during Vacation Bible School is the same thing that's happening downstairs right now. You know, sometimes when the kids run out, you know, on the one hand, you say, you know, I want them to respect the auditorium. I want them to respect God's house. But on the other hand, I love that they are so excited to go downstairs and learn about Jesus that they can't wait to get there, right? I love that. I love their energy. I love their excitement. I love their enthusiasm. And God loves it too. And God says that spending time with these kids, and spending time in particular with kids who have the greatest needs, those the fatherless, those who may be orphans, those who may be struggling. God says, that's important to me. And in fact, in Psalm 27:10, he says, when my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. So what happens, what God tells us, he says, with these children, especially the children who may not come from the best homes, who may struggle and have things to deal with that maybe our kids don't have to. God says, I'll become their father. I'll watch over them. I'll take care of them. And he calls on us as a family to do what families do and to take care of these little ones. It's pure religion. It's undefiled. It's doing something for someone who can give you nothing back in return. That's pure religion. Visiting widows, orphans and widows in their trouble. That's pure religion. It's not what we maybe think sometimes. If you look at what each of these have in common, it's a group of people who are unable to care for themselves. It's a group of people who may not have that, do not have that support system with somebody there telling them that they are loved and that they are accepted and that they are special, that their life has meaning, that their life has purpose. At both ends of the spectrum, they need to hear that. And God says, pure religion and undefiled is this. It's spending time with those people. It's people who, in fact, if you look, these are the people that Jesus spent his time with here on this earth. You know, we would kind of get this idea that when Jesus came, he would show up and there would be like at this convention or something. And all the believers would show up and they would all be there. And there would be this great gathering like we sometimes do. And it's good for us to get together. It's good to have things like Promise Keepers that they used to have and rallies and revivals and all those things. That's good. But when Jesus showed up, he wasn't spending his time with all the people who had their act together. He was spending his time with the people who did not have their act together. We talked about it last week even, in the last couple of weeks. The woman at the well. How many times have you been married? 4 times? And the person you're living with now is not your husband? He's condemned for eating with the publicans and the sinners, tax collectors and sinners. Why are you spending so much time with them and neglecting us, the religious people? He said, those who are well don't need a physician. It's those who are sick. If you look, he's at this gathering with all these adults, and the children want to come and see him. And the disciples hold him back, and they say, no, well, you know, this, he's too important for that. He's dealing with the important people right now. And what does he say? No. Let the little children come to me. Because, you see, real Christianity is not just about spending time with people who are just like us. Real Christianity is about reaching outside of our comfort zone and putting ourselves into relationships with people who have nothing to give back to us, but who we can invest into their lives and pour into their lives the love of God and give them that purpose and that meaning through the Holy Spirit of God to show them that they are special and to show them that they are loved. And that's what God calls us to do. Who does God want to help? Those who know that they need him. Let me say that again. Who is God wanting to help? Those who know that they need him. Let me ask you a question this morning. Do you really need Jesus? Or is this just like the icing on the cake for you? Is this just something else that you do? Or do you really need him? Let's look at Luke chapter 18. This is a great parable that Jesus gives. And we're going to read this. When I start reading it, many of you are going to recognize the story that he's telling. And because we recognize it, we immediately move on to, in our minds, yeah, there's two guys here, and we automatically say we're not one of these guys. But in reality, sometimes I think we are. We're either one or we're the other person in this story. And what I'd like for you to do is, as we read this parable, I'd like for you to just kind of refresh your mind. Pray to God and say, God, will you help me to see myself as I really am? Okay? Let's read this. Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse 9. Also, he spoke this parable to some, look at this next phrase, who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Now, our immediate thought is, that's not me. That's not me. But let's read on. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. Now, we kind of know who they are, but let's go back and let's kind of remember a little bit. Right? Pharisees were the guardians of the law. They were the protectors of the law. And the Pharisees, which we sometimes look at in a very negative light, but had it not been for the Pharisees, God's word would not have been preserved in the way that it was for years and years and years and years till Christ came. They were the protectors of the law. They stood up for the law. They were almost like they knew the law inside and out, and it was so important to them that they guarded it and they cherished it, and they were so concerned about not breaking God's laws that they began to make rules about not breaking God's laws. So they began to make laws about the laws, and the laws about the laws about the laws. And I've mentioned this before, but it's kind of like when my kids were young, we lived on a street that was somewhat busy, and we could say, hey, you can play in the front yard, but I don't want you to play in the street. So the rule was this: don't play in the street. So what we do is we kind of add a buffer zone to that. Okay, look, I don't want the kids playing in the street. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give them a little buffer zone. And I'm going to say, don't play on the other side of the sidewalk. Don't cross the sidewalk. And then in time, we get a little bit paranoid about that. We say, okay, look, you know what? The rule is don't play in the street. But if I keep them out of the front yard, then they're really going to be, it'd be better for them. And then we think, well, if that's good, then if I don't let them outside, then they'll never play in the street. And that's good, right? So you see what happens, that's not really good. We forgot about what the rule is and about what the purpose was. The purpose was we don't want our kids to play in the street and get hurt. But all these rules that sometimes get added on, you get to the point where you forget why you're really doing what you're doing. That's what the Pharisees did. They love God's word, but they took it to such an extreme that they created laws about the laws about the laws, and they forgot why they were doing things that they were doing. And they started doing crazy stuff, like a guy gets healed on the Sabbath, and Jesus heals him, and they condemn Jesus. And Jesus is like, wait, you forget that the Sabbath is for people. It's because people need rest. It's because I love people, and I know what they need. If your animal falls in a pit on the Sabbath, are you going to pull it out? Why wouldn't we do so much more for a real person? All right? That's the Pharisees, all right? Religious. Great intentions. But somewhere along the way, they got a little confused, a lot confused, about why they were doing what they were doing. Next group, the tax collector. The tax collector viewed more negatively than in our day. Rome was the conquering nation. The Jews were the conquered people. Taxes were exacted from the Jews and given to Rome. And the tax collectors were typically Jews who the Jews felt had sold them out. And they would take money from the Jews to give to Rome. But that's not where it ended. They would take more than they were supposed to. And they would keep the difference. The tax collectors overall had a very poor reputation of being unscrupulous, of being greedy, and of being sellouts. And the people looked down at them. Jesus sat down to eat with them, and they all said, what in the world are you doing? Why are you eating with these people? Okay? Those are the two people talked about here. Let's read the story. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men. Extortioners, unjust adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. Now I want you to stop and I want you to just look at what he's saying. I'm praying, God. I'm here at church. I'm not like these other people who are doing all these really bad things. I give money to the church. I fast, which means that I skip meals and pray instead of eating because you're important to me. God, these are all the things I do for you. These are all the things that I do for you. Now, on the surface, that doesn't sound like a bad thing. I go to church. I don't do the things these other people do. I
give money to the church. I pray. I take it very seriously. And God said that his religion was defiled. The tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified or saved rather than the other. We read this, and our tendency is to immediately look at this guy and say, what's wrong with this guy? When in reality, what he's saying is really what many of us are thinking. Okay. What's the difference between these two? The tax collector, standing far up, wouldn't raise his eyes to heaven. God, I'm a sinner. I need you. I asked you a question a minute ago. Do you need God? Or is he just something that supplements your life? The publican, the tax collector, just said, I need God. Pure religion. To God and the people that he spent time with are the people who said, I need God. Do you really think you need God? Need him. I mean, like if God took a vacation, which he doesn't do, but if he took a vacation for the next 2 weeks, how would that change your life? Drastically? Moderately? Let's go to Revelation chapter 3. Do you live like you need God? Do you pray like you need God? Because one thing you'll see is you'll see that as Jesus walked this earth, he didn't spend a lot of time with people who thought they were okay without him. Let's read this. Let's read verse 15. And again, these are familiar passages. It's Jesus speaking to the church at Laodicea. He says, I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Now let's really think about verse 17. Because you say I'm rich, become wealthy, I'm okay. I'm paying my bills. It's all good. There's a little extra in the bank. I'm rich. I've become wealthy. And I have need of nothing. In the United States, this passage is something, it's for us. You have those struggles probably every Christmas trying to figure out, what am I going to get for my son? What am I going to get for my daughter? What am I going to get for my husband? What am I going to get for my wife? Why is it so hard to go out Christmas shopping? It's because we don't need anything. We have wants, but we don't need anything. And the danger is when that spills over into our spiritual life.
Because one thing you'll see from those people who figured out that what pure religion is and that pure religion is about God spending time with people who recognize that they need him. You'll see people like Paul who says, I'm the chief of sinners. I struggle all the time. I need you, God. And I bring that up a lot because it just relates, I relate to it on a very personal place. If we don't think that we are there, and if we don't think that we need God, we've completely missed what pure religion is. We've completely missed it. We are the Pharisee in the story. Listen to what else he says. And some people get kind of offended whenever we say this. But if it bothers you, the problem is not with me, it's with the one who wrote this. Verse 17, because you say I'm rich, have become wealthy, have need of nothing, and don't know you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I stand up here this morning and say, you're wretched. You're miserable. You're poor. You're blind. And you're naked. Many times we would be upset if somebody called us that. And Jesus says, if you've forgotten that's what you are, it makes me sick. Verse 20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. And I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear to hear, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Who's he writing this to? Is he writing this to the indigent down in Cincinnati? Is he writing this to all the people who aren't in church? No, he's writing it to us. I'm a sinner. I need God. And until we come to the place where we recognize that in our lives, we are the Pharisee. There's not a person sitting in this room, regardless of what kind of house you live in or bank account that you have, achievements, there's not a person in here who does not need God. And we sometimes forget. And God sometimes becomes that other thing that we do, in addition to all the other things. Pure religion, undefiled, is God telling us to care for people who cannot care for themselves. Pure religion and undefiled is recognizing that God loves people who recognize that they need him. And if you read the New Testament and you see what he had to say about religious people who didn't think they needed Jesus, you're going to find that it's very harsh. So James starts off and he tells us. Let's read it again. Pure religion, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. I'm
I got kind of off here. I'm going to do the next half of this in 5 minutes, okay, or less. Pure religion is not just what we do. It's keeping ourselves pure as well. Unspotted from the world. I had something happen to me at Skyline a while back. And I've shared this, I don't remember if it was Sunday morning or Sunday night, but we were eating at Skyline as a family. And when I go to Skyline, by the way, it's Skyline, it's not Gold Star. I'm just saying, okay? So whenever I go to Skyline and I order my three-way, I usually order it sloppy. Three-way sloppy. That means lots of juice, I like it sloppy. I like all that stuff. Well, so I'm eating my three-way with my family, and I can't explain it. I eat every day. I usually don't have this problem. But I'm coming down to cut my three-way, and I'm pressing down pretty hard. My thumb slips off the fork, splash, into this big pile of juicy Skyline. It goes right in my daughter's eye. Bam! She looks up, her eyes burning. She's like, what just happened? You know? It was a mess. It was chili everywhere, all right? That is spotted, all right? If you eat with me at Skyline, get the bib. I'm just going to say it up front, all right? It's going to happen probably, all right? God says we're to keep ourselves unspotted from the world. If you've watched any of these CSI shows, and I don't watch a lot of those, but if you watch any of those shows, you're going to see that they can take a person and look at a crime scene, and it's particularly a person, and find out a lot of things, where that person's been, what they had to eat, who that person's been in contact with, all kinds of information. Why? Because it leaves residue on us. And what God tells us when he says, pure religion is to keep yourself unspotted from the world. He's basically saying that when we walk in this world, it splashes on us. It impacts us. It affects us. So we have to go to 1 John 1:9 and cleanse ourselves. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we have to wash up. We have to wash up through Jesus, right? Be cleansed. But the best thing is just not to get it on you. So he says, love not the world. He says, keep yourself unspotted from the world. So what is the world? Let me just read this because he tells us in 1 John 2. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Okay? All that is in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. Three things, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. So when it says love not the world, what this really means is he's actually saying stop loving the world. Not referring to people, he's referring to lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. Let me just go over the three things real quick. Lust of the flesh basically is this: life dominated by our senses. Okay? It's greedy, it's excessive, it's gluttonous, it's lustful. It's selfish use of our possessions. It's gratification. I anything that it takes to make me feel good, that's what I'm all about. And he says, lust of the flesh, to judge everything by purely material standards, my own comfort and my own ambition is my priority. Lust of the flesh. My own comfort and my own ambition is my priority. Right? Lust of the eyes. Happiness is found in the things money can buy. Pride of life. We make ourselves or think of ourselves bigger than we really are. Three things. Lust of the flesh. My own comfort is my priority. Lust of the eyes. Happiness is found in the things money can buy. Pride of life makes ourselves bigger than we think we are. We're not really everything that we think we are. Your religion. Find people who can't give us anything back and love them. It's the shut-in. It's the elderly. It's the fatherless. It's children. Recognizing that God loves those who recognize that they need Him. So we've got to ask ourselves a question. Do I live like I need God? Do you need food? Yeah. Eat food every day? Eat God? Love God? Yeah. Do you spend time with Him every day? Are there things that in our lives and priorities that maybe we need to kind of rearrange? James says this, that this is what pure religion is. It's not just coming to church. It's taking our faith and expressing it in a very real way in the world that we live in. And recognizing our need for Him as well. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You for our time together and ask You to bless it. We're very fortunate on the one hand because we are so blessed most of us sitting here today, if not all, we're just blessed beyond measure. We live at a standard that the rest of the world looks and marvels at. And then we find ourselves looking at our lifestyle and thinking it's not enough. We look at all the things that we have and all the things that we've accomplished. And look at all we have done. And forget that we really do need You. I just pray You'd help each of us. As we look at this theme for James, to find ways to express our faith. To be pure in our religion. Be careful about the things that we come into contact in our world. And once again, just recognize our need for You. In Jesus' name we pray. I invite you to stand. Heads bowed and just a quiet time before God. You need God. You need Him. Maybe you know that. And inside right now, something is crying out. I know that I need Him. And I'd like to invite you to do something. I'd like to invite you to give your heart to Him. To come to Him like the publican and just like he did and said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I need You. I need You to forgive my sins. I'm going to give my life to You. And just trust You to help me with the rest. If you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, I didn't ask if you go to church. I didn't ask if you... I'm not asking that. I'm asking, have you ever had a time in your life where you bowed your head to God and said, I need You? I'm going to place my faith and trust in what You did for me on the cross. I'm going to ask You to come into my life in this evening. If you've not done that, I'd like to invite you to come and let someone show you how you can become a child of God. If you're here this morning and we probably all struggle with this song. And you find that it's pretty easy to go through a day or days of without a whole lot of thought to God. Maybe you've forgotten that you need Him. Maybe we just need to look for ways to express our faith. Someone can't give us anything back in return. But perhaps there are things in your life that you're spotted and you know it. That's not pure religion. This time, we're just going to let the music play. You can come and pray at the altar. You can pray at your seat. You want to talk to somebody? You can talk to somebody here. You can talk to somebody after church. This time is for you as the music plays. Our goal here at this church is to not just tell us things that we want to hear, but just to show God's word undiluted and pure. Let the chips fall where they fall, and hopefully we will respond as God speaks. Heavenly Father, Lord, may we just be that kind of a church. May we be that kind of a people. Constantly looking, constantly evaluating. We can play the game of Christianity, or we can be pure. Let us be pure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.